facilities to the town. So at this time, this application has 5 lots. The road that is going to be serving 4 of those lots is proposed to be a private road. So at this time, it's still classified as a minor subdivision. The difference between a minor subdivision and a major subdivision, other than that, is that a major subdivision has to have a 2-step approval. It comes forward to the board for a preliminary subdivision approval, and then it comes back for a final subdivision approval. A minor subdivision just has a 1-step approval. However, they're reviewed under the same standards and basically have all the same submission requirements that a major subdivision would have.
Thank you. I'm just going through my notes to make sure I've tried to address all the questions that anyone has.
There was an issue of water quality.
I think Courtney said that Mr. Frastacci agreed to sample it. Does the board remember anything that I didn't remember here?
Mr. Frastacci, I'd like to ask whether you've decided who you're going to have to do your blasting and whether you could give any assurances to the gentleman who's concerned about blasting about how you intend to proceed on that.
I haven't selected anyone as yet. We have put it out to bid, and it's only 2 qualified and reputable blasters that have insurance that satisfy the town of Cape Elizabeth. All blasters have insurance policies that I think the town has to set a limit as to what the maximum coverage is. But most of them, and I'm looking to see who had that question. See, he's gone. Okay, I hope he's watching it on television. Most blasters do go around and videotape the foundations of houses and the surrounding areas. So it's not going to be a fly-by-night organization that does it, and but we will definitely make sure that they're well insured and that they do do a survey of the houses in the neighborhood.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the board?
Chair, if we close the public hearing?
Well, I will right now. I thought I had, but I will do it again.
Okay.
The public hearing is now closed.
I just didn't.
This is probably the queasiest place I have is these public hearings, when they stop and when they start and when they are halfway someplace else. So it's officially over. Now we'll talk about this.
I have one more question, Madam Chair, and that's addressed to the town planner. It always is disturbing when someone appears at a public hearing and says they have not, their property abuts the property that's under discussion, but that they've not received notice. Did we follow our normal notice provisions in this case?
Yes. I'm going to have to review again. Apparently, the notice requirements in the town of Cape Elizabeth say you have to go within so many feet or the closest 25 property owners, whichever is less. So it's a somewhat awkward way to go about it, and I've always felt that at least the abutters should be notified, even if there's more than 25 of them. And in this particular case, there could easily be more than 25 abutters. I'm gonna have to check and make sure that all people are receiving a notice. I can tell you that state law requires that once a town receives an application for a subdivision, that a notice goes out at that time. And I have been in contact with the city of South Portland, and notices were sent out in February of this year when this was first considered to be on the planning board agenda. Again, over a week and a half ago, notices were sent out for a public hearing for tonight's meeting. And again, we were provided with names of people in South Portland by the city of South Portland, plus we sent notices to people in Cape Elizabeth. And in addition, it's my understanding that Mr. Frastacci also delivered a notice to abutters to the property.
Thank you. It just sounds like we missed somebody on Angel Terrace.
It does.
Did we give the people in South Portland the same notice, the same type of notice that we...
Same exact notice.
Same exact, same rules, same abutters, everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We appreciate that, but we realize you don't have to.
We're just good neighbors. You fix the potholes on Cottage Road.
I think usually 25 abutters or a certain distance covers it sufficiently, but this is a very irregular piece of property, two different towns. Unfortunately, it didn't cover, and we all apologize if somebody didn't get...
Ms. O'Meara, will
we had sent every single public hearing, there are notices sent out to abutters and people within a certain number of feet of the project.
Honey, we didn't get one. We don't get a lot of mailings from the Cape. Tony can be gets a tax bill.
Well, we have your address.
Mr. Edsel?
I have a number of questions of the applicant. Before we start, I will say our ordinance says that we act within 60 days, and 60 days comes a day or two before our next meeting. And so I don't feel in this case that we're pressured for action, but I'm always concerned in the thought... came to me when we were talking about completeness and so forth, and I knew there was an issue why I like to push for more completeness at the point that we're talking about that. In this case, we have one meeting. We have to go for mutual agreement with the applicant to actually carry this over to the next meeting. That puts us in an uneasy position. I do have a number of questions, and perhaps our planner can explain to me. Our notes say that the end of Edgewood Road is not accepted by Cape Elizabeth. Could you explain what the ramifications are and what we need to do about that?
Based on research by the applicant and discussions with the Public Works Director, there is no such thing as Edgewood Road in the town of Cape Elizabeth. There's a paved area that extends into this property, which is commonly referred to as Edgewood Road. But there's no right-of-way that's been deeded or accepted or given to the town. The problem that's created is first of all, the Sieperts obviously use the property in front of their house to access their house, and that's the paved portion, which we commonly refer to as Edgewood Road, although legally it doesn't seem to exist. The other problem is that across the road from the Sieperts, there's Lot 4. In order to get a building permit for a lot in the town of Cape Elizabeth, you have to have sufficient frontage on an accepted town road. Not only does this lot not have enough frontage, it doesn't have any frontage, and it doesn't have any access to get to their lot from any kind of a public right-of-way. So from what I understand, what the applicant is suggesting is that there be an easement for the area in front of the Sieperts lot and in front of Lot 4, and that easement will be given to each of those lots and allow them to cross over what right now is Lot 3, which the lot that has frontage on Edgewood Road in South Portland is Lot 3. So it'll give them an easement over that portion of Lot 3 to access their homes. In addition, in order to get a public access waiver for Lot 4, there has to be a turnaround for emergency vehicles for the town to use. So the applicant is also proposing to give the town an easement over the same area as the first two lots, plus an easement for the turnaround.
Okay. I understand that the applicant is proposing to change that turnaround at the end of Edgewood, not Edgewood Road.
Yeah, the plans you have are the original design, and from the sidewalk, where I wasn't there, but it was suggested that that would be an encumbrance to the Sieperts lot, and I talked to the fire chief, and everyone seemed to think that just incorporating the driveway would be sufficient.
Okay. Could you run that by? I'm not clear. I'm not clear on what you're proposing.
The first 40 feet of this driveway would be part of the turnaround. The first, it doesn't show on this plan, but so the emergency vehicles would come in here, either coming in here or turn around there instead of having to have this. So this, in effect, is the turnaround. But it's also their driveway. They just couldn't park in that first 40 feet, and the first 40 feet will be wider, will be 16 feet wide. It'll be part of the turnaround.
Are you proposing a deed restriction on that lot itself?
Yes.
Stating that they can't park in that part and that the driveway has to be a certain width and of certain construction?
Right.
Okay. I think that requires that we certainly have a change in the plan here.
Mm-hmm.
We can't simply state that, please build a driveway and we don't want you to park there.
No, I have revised my plans. You just haven't had a copy yet. Well,
okay.
For the next meeting, I'll have revised plans and deeds and language to that effect.
At the going to the other side of the plan over on Woodland, the parcel itself is a little bit different than we typically see in that the setback to your or the property line of the subdivision sits back 25, 28 feet from what shows as the edge of the road. The site distance was shot from 26 feet from the center of Woodland Road, which puts it in some town-owned area, which is fine. That's probably where it should be shot from. It's difficult to see, and I think in the narrative of some of the writing at the press as a police officer that did the shooting of the site distance, it was difficult from a matter of elevation because there is an ledge outcropping at that point. I guess that's the issue. How much of a cut into the ledge is there? Whose responsibility is for the... My plan shows this 26, 28 feet from the edge of the road as it exists today to the edge of the property. Whose responsibility is... is it to prepare that entrance into the private drive? Number two, it cuts through ledge. There's no design, there's no requirements of how that ledge cutting, what it looks like when you're done. Could you address what your expectations are as far as treating the entrance?
Well, I assume what you're talking about, the difference between the existing road and the property line is the right-of-way, which is owned by the town.
Mm-hmm. The white space between the road that
right.
you have there and your colored area.
This is the town-owned right-of-way,
right.
correct. And the site distance was taken from our surveyors took the site distance and how they did it by the 26 feet is in the ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
I guess apparently they could... The site distance they used was from the existing.
I guess I don't have as much problem with the site distance because it actually will be probably improved a little bit. I'm more concerned about how much of a cut in the ledge is there at the point of entrance into okay. that. I mean, from my recollection of the site walk, where we ended, there was a pin for centerline right at the edge of the pavement. We stepped up onto a ledge outcropping. It shows about a 6 foot, 6 foot difference. See the profile there? Maybe it's 5 or 6 feet. I guess my concern...
The first place that there's going to be a cut is the first, about the first 100 feet, it's about a 4 foot cut there.
I'm sorry?
The entrance, the first 100 feet coming in. Do you have your profile, if you can see the profile from station 1 to 2, the dashed line is the existing grade, and the dark smooth line is the proposed grade. And so that first area of cut is about 4 feet of cut. I'm not sure exactly where the ledge is on there.
Well, from my recollection,
the center
the
of
ledge
the
is showing right
yeah.
where we stepped up there. And my concern was, is having a raw piece of ledge cut out for 20 feet or so, and how you propose to treat that so it looks like a reasonable entrance to your private drive. Talking about a visual appearance.
I guess
doing on the email.
I understand the question, I hope.
I thought you
it appears as though it's going to be about 2 feet of ledge showing. Once the blasting is done and you have the road elevation, it's approximately going to be 2 feet above ground. I plan to do some professional landscaping there, either with a stone wall and shrubs and roses.
Okay.
That's on that side. The other side is lower land, and I don't expect that there's going to be too much problem with that.
To the east side, it would be, tends to drop off toward...
the east side, I think, is where the ledge will be. And on the east side, Mitchell Road side, is where it slopes down.
Uh-huh.
And I think this is where the officer
right.
I had the situation, yeah.
Right. He thought that may have to be cut to preserve,
yeah.
Once you set the road level down.
Yeah, and that is where I expect that there will be about 2 feet of ledge showing. The other, as we're talking, this area here is the town-owned property, and this homeowner probably would like to do some dressing up there because there's some pretty ugly-looking shrub there, bushes. So we'll dress that up too, and hopefully have the lawn come right down to the road. And we're going to do this within the limits that we are allowed to do also.
I might like to see some type of indication of a plan on the entrance treatment.
Well, we want to keep it as nondescript as possible. We've been cautioned, I guess you might say, by the neighbors to leave it as natural as possible.
I agree, and I'm not talking about an elaborate entrance. I'm just saying that to leave ragged ledge, however the blaster left it, also doesn't look right.
Right.
While we're talking about ledge, it shows that on the road profile it is about a 5 to 8 foot cut at the highest point. At which point the road is 16 feet wide, or proposed to be 16 feet wide. Again, I realize this is private drive, not necessarily the road standard, but I would just like to make sure that there's some treatment to that, and that it perhaps is wider than the 16 feet. The fire chief didn't mention that, but...
Right. The roadway at the entrance is going to be a minimum of 20 feet of the paved area, and then we have to have, I think it's another 3 or 4 feet on either side for cleared area, so it's going to be a minimum of 26 or 28 feet wide.
Okay.
And this is for the emergency vehicles and all, and CMP has also put their request in to have it wider. So yeah. we may have that ledge completely gone, you know, just removed.
Okay. I'll go on to the buffering of lot 2, I think it is, and some of the neighbors mentioned that there's not a lot.
I believe that's lot 3 with the septic system would be.
Let me just.
Excuse me, lot 5.
Lot 2, excuse me, my voice is changing. Lot 2 shows a 50-foot setback between the building envelopes, and I appreciate your treatment of the envelopes. They seem quite appropriate. I'd like to suggest my recollection of walking, when we walked the site, that there was a lot of mature trees and not very much under brush, and even if it's a minimal number, 6 or so, lower level, I might turn to Mr. Emery, who might suggest some species that we might use in there as a buffer area between, I think it's the Earnhardt's house, and lot 2. Lot 5, you've got a 20 to 25 foot space between the septic system, which is a mound system, mound chamber system, or a raised chamber, I should say. I think, again, if we could see, say, not less than 5 evergreen plantings along that boundary. You mentioned on lot 1, buffering the front of that site, and perhaps that septic system with some low buffer evergreens would be a drastic improvement. That is not as bad as I first thought it was, because we've got the 25-foot setback from the town-owned land, and then there's an additional 25 feet. So, talked about the issues of the street name, and from the police, I don't think it was the chief, but a police report, or perhaps it was the fire chief, as far as numbering. What are your plans for numbering, or do you plan to name the Frustashi Drive or Lane or anything?
No, we'll go with the Rosewood as the as the name of the as the private way, and the numbering system will probably be even numbers 2, 4, 6, 8, okay. And then the other one would be identified as Edgewood, whatever number that might be. If that's, again, we have to get permission from.
Well, I have to say on behalf of the assessor's office that they reserve the right to number.
But I think the change in name was I like Rosewood better. Is more easily identified. And I thought before you had changed that, my notes, you know, either change, name the private drive, or change the name of the subdivision. You've done well with a new name, I think.
Thank you.
I guess there were some concerns about the 50-foot public access easement and the definition of that around the pond, and perhaps I'll turn to the planner, whether that requires that that's a meets and bounds description if the pond changes shape or the edge of the water changes. I mean, right now I think that's what we're utilizing. Is it a meets and bounds description from the edge of the water?
I spoke with the town attorney this afternoon, and without giving you written comments, his concerns are right now are mainly that any easement has meets and bounds descriptions attached to it and is shown on the plan, and that goes for the pedestrian easement as well as the easement around the pond.
Okay. I think that also might aid you as an owner in there, as well as defining and making it a more defined area for a public easement area. I noticed the comment about the benchmark on the plans, and I quickly this afternoon trying to find the benchmark on this plan. Is the one?
On the first plan?
I have a plan dated the 3rd of April. It's not a real big issue, but it.
I meant on the first page, the subdivision plan. On the, there should be on the, across the street from the entrance and to the left is a PK nail. It says TBM PK nail elevation. Mm-hmm. You got that on there? Yeah, that's it.
Right. You got it.
There you go.
Now I turn to the to T.Y. Lynn's comments, our engineer's comments. Does the applicant have a copy of that? I thought I was going to turn to it. Yeah. For the other planning board members, on page 2 of that, I would just suggest, if we haven't done so already, that we do contact the City of South Portland as good neighbors. Stating their acceptance of the increased runoff from Basin 4. Maureen?
City of South Portland has received copies of these plans, and I did forward a copy of this letter to them last Friday.
Very good. The comments, I just had a real short comment to begin with on the drainage ditch. Along Woodland Road, and then we had a member of the public come forward and state some concerns and show photographs of some problems that are historical there. There is a drain off from this little finger, which would be the westerlymost point, I think, southwesterlymost, right. That comes down there to the west of that. It certainly, to my recollection, seems to be uphill. and a tough way to push water to that 18-inch culvert on Woodland towards Mitchell. But there is a problem in there, and I guess your comments earlier, I'm just wondering, does the applicant consider that this is a town problem and not a subdivision problem?
I think all that we're trying to say is that we're not aggravating the problem. I mean, that's what I've been told. I think that the insignificance of the portion of Lot 1 is not going to make this problem any different than what it is. But as I said, that our engineer and the town engineer both did point out that there is an existing problem of an undersized culvert and probably should be... the best solution would be to replace it, and I'm not sure. I'm not going to say who should pay for that. I don't know.
Maureen, what would be your comment?
We're not proposing to upgrade that.
Well, we typically rely on the town engineer to make these type of reviews. However, he has made a determination that one, there is an increase in flow, and he's also made the judgment that it's insignificant. The board may want to consider accepting his first evaluation and reconsidering the second one and making that decision yourself. Yes, there is an increase in flow, but is it significant enough? Apparently, from what I've been told, that if you were to require the developer to mitigate that small an impact, any kind of detention basin would be dry all the time. So you're talking about having the developer prepare some kind of mitigating circumstance or whatever that would take care of some of the town problem as well as some of their own problem.
Say that again. No, just the last part.
Any technical redesign that would take care of the problem out there would do a lot more than just take care of the 0.1 cubic amount of flow that the developer is adding to this existing problem. And the point I was trying to make earlier is the town engineer has said there is an increase in flow, and then he said it's insignificant. You may want to accept the fact there's an increase in flow and accept his recommendation at that level, but you may want to make your own determination of whether it's significant or not.
Okay. I mean, anybody that's traveled down Woodland Road knows that there's perennially a problem there.
There's a...
And I certainly believe and understand the watershed report here, and then that the increase from this development is insignificant, mm-hmm. really, in the overall scope of what's proposed here. I guess I just admit a little bit of a loss here how to the problem and our responsibilities as a planning board when this plan comes to fruition, what you know, the people, the citizens of the town of Cape Elizabeth look at us and say, well, gee, they just approved a subdivision there, and look, we still have a mess on Woodland Road every spring or winter. I'll move on.
Madam Chair, perhaps I could suggest something on that, if Mr. Edsel would agree me that I could leap in for just a moment here.
Go ahead.
Perhaps what we could do is request the town engineer to take a second look at the situation based on Mr. Davis's suggestions this evening about how serious the problem is and our own knowledge of how serious it is, and see if we can come up with some kind of a solution that perhaps the developer could agree to. At least I think we could further investigate it.
The other thing I had thought, and I should probably keep it to myself, but I will, is that does the town have any immediate plans? No. No money, no plans. Lots of water.
Okay. My next question or comment had to do with the first culvert. I think it's at 9664, the point in the road, basically at the intersection of lot number 1 and 2. I can't, for life, I guess I didn't see that the engineer's comment that there wasn't a need for that, if that could be explained to me.
That culvert's still here. It was originally we had a culvert going under where this driveway to lot one.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And they suggested that we ditch. If you looked at the old plans, there was a culvert under lot one. Under the driveway into lot one.
So you're just saying
one.
Pitch the driveway down and, okay.
Right.
I thought that...
That culvert that's on here is still proposed.
Oh, okay. Scratch that comment.
Scratched.
In the covenants, and I'm down to only two more comments. So, in the covenants, number 7, does that comply with our town ordinance on manufactured housing? Basically says no manufactured housing shall be placed on the property at any time. I didn't pull out our ordinance.
Our ordinance allows manufactured housing under certain circumstances. And as a subdivider, I believe Mr. Frustaci can prohibit manufactured homes on his particular property, but the town isn't required to enforce those covenants on the subdivision. The only parts of the subdivision covenants that the town would enforce are parts that would otherwise, that are needed to meet the subdivision standards. For example, if the board wanted buffering of particular lots and those were set out in the covenants, then those would be parts of the covenants that the town would enforce. But now that's different from what the town's policy is towards manufactured housing, but I believe within the purview of the subdivider.
Okay. I really still have two more.
That's okay.
The question that came up about the future lots in the subdivision, mentioned in the covenants and restrictions of Ledgewood, now Rosewood. In number 9, it talks about additional property and lots. The declarant shall be entitled at any time within 20 years from the date thereof to create up to 4 additional lots and to create a continuation of the private drive. My question, and it can be through the planner, number 1, I'll use as an example, if the applicant waits 5 years and wants to add 2 lots to, or subdivide 2 lots out of his 16 acres, does that require planning board review?
I would argue at this time that's an amendment to a previously approved subdivision.
Okay, that's right. Okay, so any way we cut it, the applicant has limited within the next 20 years, a maximum of 4 additional lots. It doesn't really address, it talks about the continuation of said private drive, not necessarily as a connector street. But your understanding is that at any amendment would require returns to the planning board. Question of the applicant, and it really is a major concern of mine dealing with the septic systems themselves. I'd like to have the applicant perhaps explain to me his understanding of why there is a requirement requirement, according to your site evaluator, that all of the homes that have garbage disposals, which I take it most homes now do have garbage disposals, require 2 septic systems. Two septic tanks. Can you explain that to me?
I don't know the answer to that question.
Yeah.
Al Frick was going to be here tonight, but he's been delayed.
It's a serious problem, and in a site like this, it can pose a lot of problems. We've got standing water. That lots 1 and 2can easily drain into the wetlands area. Explain to me that there is just no basis. In other words, there's no minimum standard that requires that you have 2 septic systems, but there's a reason. In other words, there's a very good reason why you have 2 septic tanks. Garbage disposals macerate food to such a fine point that the solids never settle. They go through the first tank, lickety-split, and the second tank is there to slow it down even more and settle out. So you end up, if you don't have the 2 tanks, you're going to have silt, basically food solid silts going out into your chamber system, filling it up in a fairly short period of time. You have a non-functional system. So you end up with a human effluent flowing into the soil instead of evaporating through your chamber system. That's not what we'd like to see happen on these sites at all. And so I'm concerned that I know that there's no minimum standard for two tanks, but there is a real strong reason, and that's why Mr. Frick states that you shall put two tanks in if your homes have garbage disposals. It's a sensitive site. I just hope that the sites, I can't argue with the test pit findings. The sites are appropriately designed, but I there is a very strong reason with no basis for that type. There are now baffles, several different type of gas baffles to slow down that process, but it has become a problem with those types of sediments. I've babbled on enough. Those are all my questions or comments.
Well, we have some more. Let's see. Tom Emery?
I'll be attempt to be as brief as possible. Is this on? Can you hear me?
Is it towards you?
Yes, it is.
Okay, you're on.
It's been a while. I forgot how to use it.
Is that a hint?
I guess, first of all, I would really like to congratulate the community of Cape Elizabeth and South Portland and the developer and the consultants and our staff for bringing both communities together in a project like this and working together and trying to resolve the issues. I'm particularly pleased to see the citizens from South Portland appearing tonight and providing their input, because one of the first questions I had sitting here tonight, would people from South Portland be here and what standing would they have as non-residents of the town? So I'm very much encouraged in that process, and it's also interesting to find out about the additional trail systems. I think one of the questions which was raised is a very vital one, and that is, again, I want to congratulate Joe and his team on the sensitivity of this development, given site constraints that most sites have today, shallow bedrock, wet soils. If the site is available, it's bound to have one of those two situations. Otherwise, it would have been developed long ago or would not be offered for sale. But that issue is leaving much of the site undeveloped, and what is the impact of not only the additional development on the site, but also the notion now that rather than a dead-end quiet development, there's this opportunity for linking Cape Elizabeth into South Portland. And at least in the work that I've done in South Portland, we've often been asked to provide a master plan that would simply show the build-out potential of the site. You don't have to design it, you don't have to do engineering, but just working with the existing zoning. And I think that's something that would be very helpful to us and to the abutters, because there is no doubt a lot of development potential left in the site. There was a reference made that the remaining soils are not as good as the soils that have already been developed, but it appears, at least in first glance, that many of them are similar, and with an opportunity perhaps of extending sewer into South Portland, there may be additional density that could be gained there, whether Joe were to sell the property or develop it himself. So I would just like to see what a build-out scenario would look like for the remaining site. Either that, or I'd like a commitment that there will be no link from South Portland to Cape Elizabeth. I think it's much better to deal with us up front and
I've heard that question several times this evening. I plan to live in this house here. Okay. I don't want a road to go from woodland through my front yard into Edgewood Road. So as long as I live there, it will not happen. I expect to live there for some time. There are several issues, several concerns, several reasons why we're not